Hi guys, so this is a recorded session, and in this session I'm going to be discussing test number 5 of ESI. As I had said that in the crash course for phase 2, whatever we are going to do, there are two sets of responsibilities, one belonging to you and the other belonging to me. Now my responsibility, as I had mentioned, is to discuss about 1300 questions, not only tell you the answers of these questions, but also try and discuss how to attempt these questions, the information behind these questions, and also to tell you homework that you have to do with every question that I discuss. Okay, so these are a sets of responsibilities that we have if we really want to clear this examination. Keeping that in mind, I'm starting with the first session today. In this session, I'm going to be discussing test 5 of ESI, and today itself I will be recording one test of finance management as well, and we will move forward with this through either live sessions or recorded sessions. If it is a recorded session, I'll be telling you what you are required to do after every question. If it is a live session, then of course I'll make you write the same thing at the same time, or we will start discussing those things at the same time during the live session itself. Okay, so these are the things that we are going to do. Let us start with test number 5 of ESI. If you have not attempted the test, you can attempt it either before this session, before watching this session, or you can also attempt it after. It does not matter. What matters is what you gather from these questions, the topics that you end up covering due to these sessions. Okay, so let us start. Okay, so we'll be starting with two markers. We have a total of 35 questions of two markers, and we will have about 30 questions of one markers. Okay, so about 35 questions of two markers, 35 of two markers, and 30 questions of one markers. So this is what we are going to cover, and this is how the examination is also going to be. Starting with the first question, the question is about labor laws, as you can gather or understand from this particular line here. Before starting with any, you know, such question, it's very important that you understand what is the question. Okay, so before starting with the statement as is mentioned here, try and go through the question and try and answer the question directly itself. So the statement is whatever it is, the paragraph, not important to be covered in case you understand the question as it is. The question is, which of the following statements regarding contractual employment are certainly incorrect? So we have to identify the incorrect ones and not the correct statements. So we have to identify which of the following statements is incorrect about contractual employment. Now the beauty of this question is that it is very commonsensical question. So even if you have not read anything about contractual employment, you should be able to answer this. The options are, the service conditions of contract workers are totally different from those serving as permanent staff. Number one, service conditions of contract workers are different from those serving as permanent staff. The comparison is between contract workers and permanent staff. Looks to be fine. Contractual work in professions such as teaching discourages motivation to improve one's performance. Yes, it does. Why? Because it is not permanent. You can be removed whenever at the whims and fancies of your employer. Contractual functionaries see no or limited definite prospect of a career or future in the same profession. Yes, it happens. If you've been working as a contract worker somewhere for a long time, you don't see any future in it. Now, the beautiful thing about these statements is that all these three statements are negative, pertaining to contractual employment. They're negative for contractual employment and in favor of permanent employment. All these three statements. Let's look at the fourth statement. Fourth statement says, contractual workers are paid more than permanent staff, but they're made to work 24/7 without any work-life balance. So there is a negative connotation in this statement as well. However, there is a positive connotation, positive meaning as well. They are paid more than permanent staff, which is number one, incorrect factually, and number two, is that it is a positive statement or a statement in favor of contractual employment, which goes against all these three other statements. So even if you have not read about contractual employment, does not matter. Do not fear a question when you are just going through it. Believe that you can answer that particular question. And in this case, the answer is D, which is incorrect, because they are not paid more than permanent staff. In fact, they are paid less than permanent staff just because they are contract workers. Now, so the answer is D, and there are two articles here which I have the links I have mentioned here. In case I share the PDF, you can use these links, or you can also just type in these keywords and you will be able to go through the same link immediately. So it says commissioned by PM Council, and second is employee benefits and compensation because of code on wages, the new code on wages. So in this statement, the homework for you is, of course, I'll be covering it through further questions in the same test. The homework as of now for you is to cover the new labor laws or code on wages. A total of 4 laws have been compiled. So what are the features of those 4 laws? That is important. You have to cover those features or recommendations or whatever provisions are there in those 4 codes, because there are high chances that 1 or 2 questions will be framed out of them. Okay, so that is your homework as of now. If I cover it in further questions, your work will reduce. So this is a topic that you have to cover. Obviously, I've covered it in detail in ESI current affairs, so you can cover it from there as well if you find it. If you're not able to locate it, you can just Google it and cover it. That is your homework for this question. Okay, second question. So what does the second question say? The question says, it's a direct question without any paragraph. The question is, which are the following are reasons behind rising hypertension in rural India as per National Family Health Survey 2015-16. Now, National Family Health Survey is available in Socioeconomic Caste Census, SECC, and it is also there in the census. So the census 2011, Socioeconomic Caste Census, National Family Health Survey, and the recent updates on migration. All of them are available in one document only, in ESI. So if you've not covered it, cover it immediately, because this question has been picked up from there. High chances that 1 or 2 questions will come from either of these. So the question is, which of the following are reasons behind rising hypertension in rural India as per National Family Health Survey? The options are potassium rich diet, low level of income, higher cost of healthcare, dependence on agriculture, rising rate of migration to urban areas. Potassium rich diet is certainly not an answer, because potassium rich diet helps in reducing hypertension. That's why if you have hypertension, if your heart is not working properly, the doctors say have more coconut, have more banana. Okay, so potassium rich diet helps in reducing hypertension and not increasing it. Therefore, this is incorrect. Low level of incomes might result in more hypertension from a commonsensical point of view, even if you have not covered NFHS. Higher cost of healthcare. The cost of healthcare in rural India is less. However, the penetration of insurance is also less in rural India, and therefore, the overall cost of healthcare increases. Number 4, dependence on agriculture. That certainly is high, and because of problems in agriculture, there are high chances that hypertension or heart problems increase because of that uncertainty. So anything which has any option which has 1 can be removed immediately. So option A can be removed. 2 is correct. So B is also removed. Now we are left with C and D, 2, 3, 4 and 2, 3, 4, 5. Rising rate of migration to urban areas. Is that one of the reasons? No, it is not, because it is not a reason of hypertension. The rising rate of migration to urban areas is a result of the distress in rural India. Probably higher hypertension and problems in rural India. Therefore, people start migrating to urban areas for more opportunities. And therefore, fifth option is not a reason, but an outcome of increasing problems in rural India. Therefore, the correct option here is option C, 2, 3 and 4. And these are the options given in National Family Health Survey 2015-16. Now, the explanation here explains this. It has been found that number of people suffering from hypertension is higher in urban parts, in rural India is higher than in urban parts. Higher stress levels in rural India and faulty diet in cities have thrown up the two most disturbing health trends. Overall, obesity in urban India and rising hypertension in rural India. These two conclusions have been drawn by health experts through National Family Health Survey. Okay, what are the main reasons? The main reasons are income, agriculture, high cost of health in rural India. Also, on the food front, there is lack of potassium. Rich food like fruits and vegetables, lack of potassium and not a potassium rich diet. So what the first option was opposite of what it should have been. That's why it is incorrect. I hope you've understood it. Now the homework for you is, you have to go through NFHS. It will take you just 10-15 minutes to go through entire National Family Health Survey. That is what you have to do. You know where it is. I've already explained that. Third question. Another direct question. The second phase of rooftop solar program has a target of dash gigawatt of grid connected rooftop solar energy by 2022. You've already seen the answer, but let me tell you the answer is 40 gigawatt. So the target is 40 gigawatt of grid connected rooftop solar energy. So that is only grid connected rooftop solar energy has a target of 40 gigawatt. There are other targets as well. The main target is 100 gigawatt of solar capacity by 2022, out of which 40 gigawatt is supposed to be grid connected rooftop solar energy. Okay, this is something that you need to remember. A question I believe can be framed out of this. Total target of solar 100 gigawatt, out of this rooftop solar 40 gigawatts. Next question. The World Development Report 2017 titled Governance and the Law deals with SDG 16. What does SDG 16 aims for? So what is the main aim of SDG 16? This brings the importance of all the SDGs. So let us, before coming to the answer, let us come to all the SDGs. I have mentioned here all the SDGs. The first SDG is about poverty, P. Second is about hunger, H. Third is about health and well-being, double H. Fourth is about education, E. Fifth is about gender, G. Sixth is about water and sanitation. Seventh is about energy. Eighth is about economic growth. Ninth is about industry, innovation and infrastructure. Let's write it as I. Tenth is about inequality. Let's write it as IQ, inequalities. 11th is about sustainable cities, so sustainability S. 12th is about responsible consumption and production, so C, consumption. Then you have climate action, so CL. Then you have life below water as 14th, water. So this is about clean water, this is life below water. 15th is life on land. 16th is peace, justice and strong institutions. We can name it as governance also. And 7th is partnership for the goals. So partnerships for various goals. These are the 17 SDGs. You just have to mug them up. Don't try to understand them, beyond a certain point, because some things have to be mugged up. So mug up all the 17 numbers. That is your first objective. Second is, what are the targets of all these one by one that are important? Okay. So all these goals have a total of 169 targets. You need not cover all 169 targets, but the major targets. I've already mentioned them in growth and development PDF. All the major targets, whether it is zero hunger by 2020 or zero poverty by 2030, whatever the targets are, they're mentioned there. So try and remember them. I've also discussed it in a video for the enrolled students. So you can cover it from there also in order to try and remember it. The objective here is to remember major targets, number one, and secondly, to remember all the goals, because questions on goals can be prepared and can be asked like this. The question says, again, let's come back to the question. The World Development Report 2017 titled Governance and Law deals with SDG 16. What does SDG 16 aim for? So as I said, SDG 16 can be summarized as governance. So this one is the answer: peace, justice and strong institutions, which is basically the gist of governance or expansion of the overall umbrella of governance. Okay, perfect. So let's jump to the next question. The question is, which organization measures the Global Environment Performance Index? Which organization measures the Global Environment Performance Index? WWF, United Nations Environment Program, International Union for Conservation of Nature, IUCN, and World Economic Fund, WEF. The answer is WEF. Your homework is, it's going to take only 2 minutes to go to the document on indices and reports. Okay, immediately just go to the document of indices and reports in your laptop, and in that search for Control F WEF. You will find certain indices and reports being given by or being released by World Economic Forum. You have to write down and try and remember or just revise all those reports and indices which are released by World Economic Forum. India has been ranked at 177 out of 180 institutions in the Global Environment Performance Index, and rank 1 belongs to Switzerland. Next question, a paragraph based question again. There has been a decline of 6.9% in the area of crops sown this summer, according to the latest data published by Union Ministry of Agriculture on July 19, 2019. Decline of 6.9% in the area of crops sown this summer, according to Ministry of Agriculture. Rice has been sown on 14 million hectares, down from 15.1. So this is talking about the area being sown for agriculture. Question is completely unrelated, although it is in from agriculture, but it is not related to the area sown. And this is how a lot of questions are framed. The paragraph does not help you directly in answering the question at a lot of times. The question is, which of the following is the correct objective of Model Agricultural Produce and Livestock Marketing Committee, APLMC, which was launched or released recently? The options are to help farmers directly connect with the different buyers and enable them to discover optimum price for their commodities, to help farmers indulge in mixed farming activities, to encourage local production and local distribution of food products, to help farmers double their income by farming staple crops like rice and wheat, which are a part of MSP. Now, this is something which is already happening, and the government is trying to move away from this by encouraging people not to limit themselves to farming only staple crops, but also to farm other crops like pulses, oil seeds, geographically local crops. Therefore, this seems to be incorrect. The question is about Model Agricultural Produce and Livestock Marketing Committee. Now, if you have read a little about agriculture and market, you would know that APMCs are a big problem now because they limit the extent to which, or they limit the selling power of the farmer. According to APMC, if this is a farmer and if this is a consumer, let's say this is a consumer and this is a farmer. Now, the farmer, in order to sell to the consumer, cannot go directly. He has to go through this mandi, which is called as APMC mandi. And this mandi consists of middlemen who buy at low prices from the farmers because they know the farmer cannot go directly to the consumer, and sell at high prices to the consumer. So the purpose of this Model Agricultural Marketing Committee Act is to enable farmers to be able to sell directly to the consumer. That is the biggest reform that they're trying to bring. And that is what this APLMC Act is all about. Therefore, logically, even if you have not read about APLMC, if you just know what is APMC and how this is a problem and how through ENAM, the government is trying to destroy or to make APMCs ineffective in the future is through ENAM, and the purpose is this: to help farmers directly connect with different buyers and enable them to discover optimum price for their commodities. No work on mixed farming under APLMC and no work on local production and local distribution. Although they are encouraging mixed farming and they are also encouraging local production distribution, they are also encouraging doubling of farmer income, but these do not form a part of APLMC. Okay. Your objective, your homework is to read a little about APLMC so that if a question comes on APLMC, you know about it. Some explanations are mentioned here. The Dalwai Committee on Doubling Farmers' Income has pointed out that the share of farmers in consumers' price is very low, varies between 15% and 40%. So if you're paying, let's say, 100 rupees per kg, the farmer is getting somewhere between 15 to 40 rupees for it, which is very less. He should be getting a majority share of it, but he's getting only a minority share of it. This is as per Dalwai Committee. Studies conducted by International Food Policy Research Institute and World Bank have confirmed this. Dominant role of middlemen, among others, is primarily responsible for this problem. This was also recognized in the 12th plan on 12th plan's working group on agricultural marketing in 2011. And since then, this issue has been going on, but it has yet not been resolved. Okay, let's come to the next question. Again, a paragraph based on results, some kind of election is we're talking about problems, employment, droughts, crippling point, tribals. That is all you see. You go through the question first and see if you can answer it without having to go through the paragraph. Question is, consider the following statements regarding Democracy Index 2018 and identify the correct ones. You have to identify the correct ones, not the incorrect ones. The index classifies countries into four types: full democracy, flawed democracy, hybrid, and authoritarian democracy. So what you have to do, number one, is go through Democracy Index yet again. Although I've discussed it in indices and reports, it is available there. and some questions were also discussed. But if you don't remember, your homework for this question is open indices and reports right away and go through it. Okay, index, let me discuss the democracy index in brief as well here. Yes, this one is correct. Indices does classify countries into four types: full, flawed, hybrid and authoritarian. It is based on five parameters. India has been classified as a flawed democracy. This is also correct. Pakistan has been classified as a hybrid regime. This is also correct. Yes, it is based on five parameters. A total of 189 countries are ranked under democracy index. This is incorrect. So a completely factual, a question wherein facts have played a more important role. Therefore, even if you have all the idea about democracy index, but if you don't remember the facts, you will get it wrong. See, the answer to this question is 1, 2, 3 and 4 are correct. Fifth is incorrect. It is not for 189 countries. It is for 167 countries. It is mentioned here. The Economic Intelligence Units, EIU, is the unit or organization which releases democracy index. And according to EIU, 167 countries are classified into four types: authoritarian, hybrid, flawed and full democracy, based on five parameters. Okay, India has slipped to 42nd place in the annual global democracy index. So from 32nd, I think they have slipped to 42nd. Yeah, that's what it says. From 32nd a year before, we have now skipped to 42nd place because of rising religious sentiments or religious violence in the country. The index ranks 165 independent states and two territories on the basis of five categories, and these are the five parameters which are not so important, but you can go through them: electoral process and pluralism, civil liberties, functioning of the government, political participation and political culture. Okay, let us start with question number 8. The question says, which of the following are reasons for a high CAD, current account deficit, in India? Number 1, Indian output is below its potential. Number 2, Indian savings are less than investments. Number 3, there is unutilized labor capacity. Number 4, India is heavily dependent on oil imports for its energy needs. Now, even if you have read the basics about CAD, you would know that 4th is certainly right. Yes, it is a reason for high CAD in India because of this necessary oil import that we are dependent upon. So 4 is certainly right. So wherever 4 is not there, you remove that. So you're left with only two options. All are reasons for high CAD. 1, 2 and 4 are reasons for high CAD. Now the controversial point is 3. There is unutilized labor capacity. There is no unutilized labor capacity. The labor capacity which is skilled and required is utilized to the maximum potential as per the economic survey. So this question has come directly from economic survey, the recent 2019. Okay. So option 3 is incorrect. Indian output is below its potential. That is because economic growth is below what it should be. Savings are less than investments. Yes, and that is why we have to borrow, which results in high CAD. And yes, India is heavily dependent upon oil imports. Therefore, the options are 1, 2 and 4 and not 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so the correct answer option is D. 1, 2 and 4 are reasons for high CAD. Let us start with question 9. So question 9 says, which of the following is not a negative impact of disinvestment program of the government? Not a negative impact. So you identify the negative impacts of disinvestment and then you figure out which of the following is not a negative impact, because directly finding out not a negative impact might be difficult. Okay. So if you reframe the question, find out what are the negative impacts. Number 1, disinvestment might result in monopoly like situation in the market. Okay, yes, this looks like a negative impact on the face of it directly. So this is a negative impact. Can be used to inflate government surplus in the short run. Yes, this is something that is happening. Negative impact. Can be used to limit government functioning to welfare activities for which it is elected by the government. It is a negative impact. It is a positive impact and therefore not a negative impact. Disinvestment can be used to make Sikh units more professional and profitable in the future. Not a negative impact. So this is a positive impact, because yes, disinvestment can be used to make Sikh units more professional and profitable in the future. So 3 and 4 are not negative impacts, in fact are positive impacts. So our answer is only 3 and 4 are not negative impacts. Not only 3, but only 3 and 4. Option C. Can be used to make Sikh units more professional and profitable in the future. It is not a negative impact of disinvestment program. In fact, option D is a positive impact of disinvestment program. Okay, so the answer is Option C, only 3 and 4 are not negative impacts. 10th question is on finance commission. So instead of going through the entire paragraph, let's have a look at the question first and see whether we can answer the question directly or not. 14th finance commission mandated prudent levels of fiscal deficit and debt to GDP ratio for state governments that must not be breached. The upper limit of fiscal deficit was 3% of state GDP. The upper limit prescribed for debt to GDP ratio was how much? The answer is direct 25%. Because it is a factual question, therefore there is no logic behind it. It is just 25%. The answer option is C. A little bit about 14th Finance Commission. Tax devolution is increased from 32% to 42%. Majority of you must be aware about that. Now, what are the weights for tax devolution? This is where we forget or we get it wrong. 17.5% out of this 42% weightage is for 1971 population. 10% is for 2011 population. 15% is for area. 7.5% is for forest cover. Income distance, 50%. Distance of state's income from the state having the highest income is given 50% weightage. So these are the weights. You have to remember them. A question can be framed out of this. Fiscal deficit target 3%. Debt to GDP ratio target is 25%. Grants to local governments are to given in two parts, basic grant and performance grant. So if you are giving some grants to local governments, they are based on two things, basic grant, performance grant. For gram panchayats, it is different. For municipalities, it is different. For gram panchayats, 90% basic grant, 10% performance grant. For municipalities, 80% basic grant, 20% performance grant. Okay, and the concept of effective revenue deficit, which was introduced during the time of UPA, has now been removed. If you want, you can also read a little about effective revenue deficit as well. Next question. Question is on World Economic Outlook. It's a report by IMF. IMF releases World Economic Outlook on a yearly basis. Without going through the paragraph, let's look at the question and see if we can answer it. It's a factual question. So I believe going through the paragraph is not going to help much. So you can skip the paragraph, save some time. What is the projected growth rate of India for the fiscal year 2020 as per World Economic Outlook? Okay, World Economic Outlook. What does it say about growth of India in 2020? Now, these have been released and, changed on a regular basis. Therefore, it might be a different one now. But as on yesterday, the forecast by World Economic Outlook of IMF is 7% for India for the year 2020. So for 2020, they say 7%. Now, this brings us to another homework. All the GDP forecasts, I have already discussed all the GDP forecasts for India as well as the entire world. It was, I think, the session was on 15th October, and it is there, also there on Infinity. Now, you have to go through the entire document once again before moving on to the next question. So pause the video, go on to that particular either video or the PDF and revise the entire growth projections of India as well as global growth projections by different organizations. Okay, do that immediately. That will help you remember a lot of things much more. Next question. It is about LFPR, labor force participation rate. The question is, which of the following correctly explains care economy in terms of female LFPR, labor force participation rate? Now, this has been taken from the recent periodic labor force survey. The options are the amount of time spent by women on works like household, maid, creche, etc. The amount of time spent by women on doing secretarial work in organizations not utilizing their true potential is care economy. The amount of time spent by women on household chores in the family. The amount of time spent by women on dealing with alcoholic husbands. So these are the four options that we have. The correct answer is C. And it is very easy to identify, because even if you don't know what LFPR says on labor, on care economy, or what family health survey says periodic labor force survey says on care economy is that part of the economy which is not considered or not counted under GDP, but instead, even then, which is contributing towards our GDP growth. And that is the amount of time spent by women on household chores in the family, which let the men work, which let the men utilize their potential. Let's come to the next question, which is question 13. Now, the question talks about EPFO, Employees Provident Fund Organization. there has been some major changes in EPFO rules, and they have been discussed in ESI current affairs as well as in finance current affairs in the past 6 months. Therefore, I'm not going to pick up the entire changes yet again, but we will talk about certain important aspects or provisions of EPFO. The options are, employees are required to invest 12% of their basic salary to EPF as per EPFO rules. This is very true. Out of this, 8.33 goes to EPS and 3.67 goes to EPF. The contribution of every employee to EPF is capped at 15,000 per month. Is it correct? We don't know. There is no cap on salary used to calculate monthly pension under EPFO. Is there a cap on salary on which you can invest up to a certain limit under EPFO? No, there is not. EPFO rules provide for investment in EPS and EPF, EPS being 8.3% and EPF being 3.67%. So we have to identify the correct ones. First one is for sure correct. Third one is for sure correct, that we know. Fourth one is also correct, EPS 8.3, EPF 3.6. So 1, 3 and 4 are certainly correct, and that is there in the options, option E. And the other confusion is option A, which says all are correct. That means second one is also correct. The contribution of every employee is capped at 15,000 per year. No, it is not so. The contribution is not capped at 15,000. There are a lot of provisions which contain the fact or the number 15,000, but this is not one of them. So the correct answer is option E. Now the homework that you have is to cover Employees Provident Fund Organization and all its major provisions immediately after this particular question. Now these are some of the changes that I have mentioned here. I have picked it up directly from ESI April. So in ESI monthly magazine of April, you will find detailed explanation on EPFO. 15,000 limit removed. EPFO had capped the salary used for computation of pension at rupees 15,000, which has now been removed. Employees covered by EPF will now be eligible for pension as per their full last drawn salaries. If an individual salary was 10,000 per month and rose 10% every year, it would be 61,000 now. So his pension will be determined based on 61,000 and not on 15,000. So previously EPFO, what it was doing was, let's say your monthly salary is 1 lakh at the time of retirement. Even then, your pension will not be based upon 1 lakh, but will be based upon only 15,000. So pensioners kept on getting a very meager sum as pension, even when they were actually contributing a major part of their salary under EPFO as pension. The third one is, the cap on 15,000 on the basic salary was removed with the Supreme Court dismissing the petition, challenging the Kerala High Court. Subscribers will be eligible to get pension based on their actual basic plus DA and not the cap on 15,000, which I just mentioned in point 2 as well. So it's an explanation of point 2 only. I hope you have understood EPFO now. Please go through the detailed document to get more clarity on it. That is your homework to be covered immediately. Next question. IMD maintains 5 rainfall distribution categories on an all India scale. Which among the following is not one of them? Normal or near normal plus minus 10%, which means if it is 100%, then minus 5% and plus 5%, that makes it plus minus 10%. Below normal is less than 10% of long period average. That means if the less than 10% is 96, it comes out to be 96 because it is 5 less than 100. Then if it is between 90 to 96, it is below normal. Above normal is 104 to 1110. If it is beyond the normal, and the normal was a range of plus minus 10% based on 100%. If it is beyond that, then it is above normal. Deficient is, if it is less than 90%, then it is deficient. And excessive is if it is more than 110%. I hope you have understood the classification. If you want me to simplify it further, I can do so. So 100 is the, so this is the normal, 96 to 104. This is the normal. If you go towards 90, this is below normal. If you go beyond 90, less than 90, then it is deficient. So this is the field of deficient. If you go towards 110, it is above normal. And if you go below, beyond that, this is excess, E. So this kind of table or this kind of representation can help you remember it. Of course, all the options are correct. That's why I wanted to explain it through these options. Next question, match the following about India according to World Population Report as per UNFPA. About India we have to identify. On the left hand side we are given percentage of population, and on the right hand side we are given age bracket. So percentage of population, how much percentage of population is in which age bracket for India? 27% comes in 0 to 14, 67% comes in 15 to 64, let's go down a little bit, 6% comes in 65 and above, 15% or 27%, where do they lie? Now the answers, correct answers are A belongs to 1, because yes, 0 to 14 years is 27% of Indian population today. 15 to 64 is major population, which is 67%. 65 and above is very minor population, 6%. But 27% of the population is in between 10 to 24. So 0 to 24, 27%, and 0 to 14, 27%, and then 10 to 24 also is 27% of India's population. This is where a lot of students face problems and confusion, and they are not able to remember the correct facts. So the answer is A1, B2, C3 and E4, not D4. So the answer is B, A1, B2, C3 and E4. Let's move to the next question. As per Ministry of Commerce and Industry, what is the export performance of India in 2018-19? Now this was also discussed in ESI Current Affairs. As soon as Ministry of Commerce came out with their facts based upon the export performance and import performance of India. The answer to this question is A, export of $535 billion. Let me cover in ESI from ESI April the chart that I had picked up from Ministry of Commerce and Industry. And one more thing that you need to remember is that the newspapers misread this chart and gave some other information, but I had to go on to the Ministry of Commerce's website to find out the correct facts. So there is overall trade, there is services trade, and there is merchandise trade, and questions can be asked on any one of these three. So these three hold a lot of importance, all the facts. Export of merchandise is 331, export of services 204, total exports as was asked above is 535, import of merchandise is 507, import of services is less than export, which is 123, and total imports are 631. So the total gap between export and import is 95.85 billion. However, the trade deficit in merchandise is more at 176, whereas services are in a surplus zone at 80.57 billion US dollars. Okay, so these are the facts that you need to remember, certainly without which you will lose out very important yet very easy marks. Next question. As per Ministry of Commerce, what is the trade deficit of India in 2018-19? A question picked up from there. Trade deficit is 95.85, that is approximately 95 billion US dollars. So the answer is option A. Next question, consider the recommendations of Mohan Reddy Committee and find the incorrect one. Options are undergraduate economic programs should be set up exclusively for artificial intelligence, blockchain, robotics, etc. You have to find out the incorrect one. No additional seats should be approved in traditional engineering areas, no additional seats. Stop setting up new colleges from 2025. The existing engineering institutes need to move from providing traditional engineering knowledge towards upcoming subjects like cyber security, 3D printing, etc. Now, it's a factual answer because all these three for your information have been kept correct here, whereas the correct recommendation was to stop setting up new colleges, traditional new colleges from 2020, so that we can focus upon the existing colleges and we can improve the syllabus or the curriculum of these existing colleges by including artificial intelligence, blockchain, robotics, etc., etc. So the answer option is C. These are the recommendations that have been mentioned here. Stop setting up new colleges from 2020 and review creation of new capacity. No additional seats should be approved in traditional engineering areas. No additional seats in traditional engineering areas and not in the new areas. For approving additional cities, AICTE should only give approvals based on capacity utilization of concerned institute. Introduce undergraduate engineering programs for artificial intelligence exclusively, blockchain, robotics, etc., etc. So although this looks like a incorrect option, this is in fact a correct option. Next question. Tax correction for the year 18-19 has increased from 6.8 lakh crore to how much? It's a factual question. The answer is 12 lakh crore, and this is for tax collection for the year 2018-19. No other facts available. Next question. Which of the following are true regarding the state of malnutrition as per National Family Health Survey? Number of people suffering from hypertension in rural India is higher than in urban parts. We discussed it in first question, I believe, if I'm not wrong. So this is correct. India accounts for 1/3 of world's burden of stunting. This is actually correct. Over one in three children is stunted in India. This is also a correct option. So the options are all are true. All three are true. Your homework is to cover the facts of National Family Health Survey on malnutrition. You have the NFHS document with you. Please revise it immediately after this question, not after this entire session. Pick it out from the Infinity if you have not downloaded it yet and cover it immediately. That will help you remember it. Next question about rural women being a part of workforce in India. Some paragraph. Without going through the paragraph, let's first go through the question and see if we can answer it directly or not. The question is, to improve the present status of women in agriculture and to enhance the opportunities for her empowerment, government has announced Mahila Kisan Sashaktikaran Pariyojana. So your homework is to read on Mahila Kisan Sashaktikaran Pariyojana. I will also be covering it after this question. As a subcomponent of which mission? So which mission is an umbrella mission for Mahila Kisan Sashaktikaran? That means rural agricultural women farmer. That is the meaning of Kisan, Mahila Kisan Sashaktikaran. Empowerment of rural women agricultural farmers. National Rural Livelihoods, Deen Dayal Upadhyay, Grameen Kaushalya, Rozgar Protsahan or Mission Antyodaya. The answer to this question is A. It is a part or subcomponent of National Rural Livelihoods Mission. So Mahila Kisan Sashaktikaran Pariyojana is a subcomponent of NRLM. It was launched in 2010-11 by Ministry of Rural Development. So one question that can be asked is, Mahila Kisan Sashaktikaran Yojana, Pariyojana comes under which ministry? Number two, it is a subcomponent of NRLM. Number three, what are the focused areas? Community managed sustainable agriculture, non-pesticide management, zero budget natural farming, Pashu Sakhi model, sustainable regeneration and harvesting of non-timber forest produce, and all these are focused on increasing the empowerment of women in rural India, especially the rural women farmers. Okay, so this is the chart which is available in the summary document of government schemes. Even if you have not gone through it, go through it. I picked it up from there. Next question. I hope now we have revised Mahila Kisan Sashaktikaran Pariyojana. The next question is, Ministry of Human Resource Development has launched the Impress scheme. So your homework or the question from you is, what is the full form of Impress? Try and answer it immediately without looking at the options, without looking at your notes or whatever. Being implemented by ICSSR, Indian Council of Social Science Research, with a total cost of 414 crore. So this is information that you're getting from where questions can be asked. Its main objective is to identify and fund research proposals in which subject? Because it is launched by Indian Council of Social Science Research, therefore the option comes out to be option B. Even if you don't know what it is for, if you know the full form of ICSSR, you would be able to answer this question. So that is how common sense works. And social science, comes out logically. Even if you don't know, double S has to mean social science or should, and therefore you can also take a fluke here. Explanation on IMPRESS. The full form of IMPRESS is Impactful Policy Research in Social Science. Launched to promote policy research in social sciences. A total of 1500 research projects will be funded for 2 years. ICSSR, at a total project cost of 414 crore, is carrying out or implementing this entire scheme. It was launched in 2018 under Ministry of Human Resource Development. Remember that also. So even without going through the paragraph, you can actually come to the answer if you go through the question and if you realize that you can come to the answer through either common sense or you have read about it. Research is a bird of another feather. Not only do we require first-rate infrastructure in terms of laboratories, so we're talking about research here. So the question is also related to research only. The question is SPARK initiative. The full form of SPARK, that is something you have to remember and write it down if you don't. Okay. SPARK initiative launched by Ministry of Human Resource Development. That is another set of information that can be asked in the examination. For improving research ecosystem of India's higher educational institutions by providing what? Options are number one, facilities to promote industry-specific need-based research in educational institutions, scholarship and stipend to the talented and potential researcher, funds for improving infrastructure of research universities, academic and research collaborations between Indian and foreign institutions. So SPARK is specifically for collaboration between Indian and foreign institutions. The name also explains it. So, if you know the full form, you should be able to come to the right answer. Scheme for promotion of academic and research collaborations, that is what is used here. So, normally through common sense, you can jump to the answer even without knowing the answer, even if you just know the full form of SPARK. Okay. Launched in 2018 by Ministry of HRD, and the quality benchmark is only top 100 universities as per NIRF of India can participate, and according to QS, Quackerelli Simons, only top 500 can participate. Okay, IIT Kharagpur is the national coordinating institute to implement SPARK scheme, not IIT Delhi, IIT Kharagpur for SPARK. Remember that. Next question, Ek Bharat Shrestha Bharat was announced on the occasion of 140th birth anniversary of Vallabhbhai Patel by the Ministry of HRD. What is the objective of the scheme? Removing all obstacles taking admission in other universities or schools across India, applying same tax system and tax norms across India, promoting same educational techniques and syllabus, promoting greater mutual understanding and bonding amongst people of diverse cultures. Now, Vallabhbhai Patel is not all about education. Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel is all about unity, and therefore the name of the statue is also Statue of Unity. Therefore, the natural answer that comes is answer or option D. And that is the correct answer here, option D. Launched with the objective of promoting greater mutual understanding, every year states are paired with other states for reciprocal interaction among people. Rashtriya Ekta Shivir, that is National Integration Camp, is also organized, and it comes under Ministry of Human Resource Development. So Rashtriya Ekta Shivir comes under what? Comes under Ek Bharat Shrestha Bharat. That is also another set of information that is important that can be asked. The next question is also related to government schemes, and this one particular is about Jigyasa. Let's go through the question without going through the paragraph and see if we can answer it. The question says, Jigyasa, a student scientist connect program to inculcate the culture of inquisitiveness on one hand and scientific temper on the other. Which are the two collaborating bodies to implement this program? IIFT and Central Board of Secondary Education, CSIR and Kendriya Vidyalaya, IIT and NCERT, Terry and Navodaya Vidyalaya Samiti. A very factual question. Let's go through the paragraph and see if this helps a lot. The paragraph says, to inculcate a scientific temper among the students, we have to make them aware about the impact of science on society. Science has played a very important role in changing our lives. The Jigyasa would inculcate the culture of inquisitiveness on one hand and scientific temper on another. So all that the paragraph does is clarifies on the objective of Jigyasa. So what it does is, it mentions you the objectives of Jigyasa. However, the objectives of Jigyasa have already been mentioned here and therefore do not help us in answering the question. So the objectives here are not at all helpful in answering the question because it's a very factual question. Let's have a look at the answer. The answer option is B, CSIR and Kendriya Vidyalaya Sangathan. What is Jigyasa? It's a student scientist connect program by Ministry of HRD and Ministry of Science and Technology. It was launched in July 2017. What is the purpose? The focus is to extend students' classroom learning to research laboratories by visiting CSIR laboratories. Okay, so it's a connection between students and researchers. CSIR and Kendriya Vidyalaya Sangathan are collaborating to implement this program. Okay. Very factual question, but a very important scheme. The next paragraph is on education policy. Let's have a look at the question. The question says, draft on new education policy has been released. Which option is correct about the foundational pillars of the policy amongst the following? Now, new educational policy was also asked in NABARD, and I'm expecting at least one question in RBI as well. Therefore, your homework related to this question is to read on the draft new education policy. I've already explained this or mentioned it in ESI section. It is available there. And it is also being explained in Spotlight. But if you don't want to go through Spotlight again, you can go through ESI Current Affairs. It is available there, a detailed document on draft new education, national education policy. The options are the following, A, B, C, D. I'm not going through the options. The correct answer is C, access, equity, quality, affordability and accountability. So triple A's are access, affordability, accountability. And then you have EQ, equity and quality. So these are the five basic foundational pillars of new national education policy. A little bit about this particular policy. MHRD has released this policy in 2019. A committee was set up under K. Kasturi Rangan. That is another question that can be asked. Foundational pillars I've already explained. Renaming MHRD as Ministry of Education, that is one recommendation. Free and compulsory education from 3 to 18, not from 6 to 14. Extension of right to education to cover 3 to 18 based on 5-3-3-4 curriculum. 5 plus 3, 8, 8 plus 3, 11, 11 plus 4, 15. So total of 15 years. 4-year integrated state specific B.Ed program will eventually be the minimum degree qualification for teachers. So making it more difficult for people to become teachers so that they are more qualified. 4-year, not 3-year, 4-year integrated B.Ed program should be made compulsory in order to become teachers. In higher education, a restructuring of higher education institutions with three types of higher education institutions. Two missions, Mission Nalanda and Mission Takshashila, to be reforming or transforming the higher education in India. A new apex body, Rashtriya Shiksha Aayog. What is the purpose? To coordinate efforts between center and states. A national research foundation to be created for research culture in India, because in India the research culture has been very down. Private and public institutions will be treated on par, and education will remain a not-for-profit activity. So this is one area where a question can be created wherein they can say whether it is a profit activity or not-for-profit activity. Okay. Promotion of Indian and classical languages and setting up three new national institutes for Pali, Persian and Prakrit. An Indian Institute of Translation and Interpretation, Indian Institution of Translation and Interpretation has been recommended. So all these are major recommendations. Please remember them. I've just mentioned them here. Next question about NSSO survey. Let's have a look at the question. Okay, the question is about NSSO survey about micro units and enterprises. However, the question is about Mudra. So the question is, with regards to Mudra Yojana, consider the following statements. Mudra stands for Micro Units Development and Reconstruction Agency. We have to find out the incorrect or incorrect statements. This is incorrect because it is not reconstruction, it is refinancing. It was launched under Ministry of Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises. This is also incorrect. It was launched in the Ministry of Finance. Loans are classified into three categories. This is correct. Yes, Shishu, Kishore and Tarun. These are the three categories of loans. No collateral security. Yes, this is also correct. And Mudra card on RuPay platform. This is also correct. So the correct options are 3, 4 and 5. So the answer option is D. I have already mentioned Mudra Yojana in detail in Finance Current Affairs. However, let's go through the basic provisions of Mudra Yojana. It was launched in 2015 under Ministry of Finance, as I said. Mudra stands for Micro Units Development and Refinancing Agency and not Reconstruction. Okay. Credit limit is 10 lakh and the sub-classification or subdivision of 10 lakh is up to 50,000 loan is called Shishu, 50,000 to 5 lakh is called Kishore and 5 lakh to 10 lakh is called Tarun. No collateral security required for Mudra, and Mudra card, which is a debit card, has been given or is to be given for utilizing working capital limit by people who take on Mudra loans. Okay. So these are all the major provisions of Mudra. Now your work or your homework is to read on Mudra online. You can just go to the website of Mudra and look at the recent facts That is the maximum thing that you can do. Look at the recent facts. What are the coverages, recent coverages of Mudra? Next question. This is about households being covered for banking, opening of banking accounts. Let's have a look at the question. The question says, to ensure access to financial services, Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana is implemented by Department of Financial Services. What is not correct about the scheme? What is not correct about the scheme? Option A, slogan of the scheme is Mera Khata Bhagya Vidata. Option B, it has been listed in the Guinness Book of World Records for opening maximum number of bank accounts in 1 week. Option C, in phase 3, the free accident insurance cover has been doubled to 4 lakh. And option D, it facilitates opening of banking accounts with zero balance. So first one is slogan of the scheme, Jan Dhan Yojana is Mera Khata Bhagya Vidata, which is correct. Second, it has been listed in the Guinness Book of World Record for maximum number of bank accounts in 1 week. This is also correct. The free accident insurance cover has been increased or doubled, but it has been doubled to 2 lakh. Therefore, this is incorrect. And the fourth one is, it facilitates opening of bank accounts with zero balance, which is also correct. Yes, it allows opening of bank accounts with zero balance. Therefore, the only incorrect option is option C. PM Jan Dhan Yojana, a flagship financial inclusion scheme, allows opening of bank accounts with zero balance. Slogan of the scheme is Mera Khata Bhagya Vidata, correct. Launched in 2014 by Department of Financial Services under Ministry of Finance. Two phases are completely and third phase is going on. In the third phase, OD limit has been increased to 10,000. It was 5,000 before, it is 10,000 now. And no condition for overdraft limit of up to 2000. So these are important facts. Please remember these three, although the question did not have them. Age limit revised from 18 to 60 to 18 to 65 years for overdraft facility. OD is overdraft facility. If the company or the individuals on whose name, not the company, the individuals on whose name the bank account is, have to be between 18 to 65 in order to utilize the OD facility. Free accident insurance, 2 lakh, not 1 lakh. And yes, it is listed in the Guinness Book of World Records for opening maximum number of bank accounts in 1 week, which happened in 2014 itself when it was launched. Next question, the Government of India has initiated a number of social security schemes to boost the financial stability of its citizens. So it is about schemes on social security. Let's have a look at the question without going through the entire paragraph. The question is a merged scheme for two schemes, Aam Aadmi Bima Yojana and Janashri Bima Yojana, and renamed as Aam Aadmi Bima Yojana, which is very surprising, administered by LIC, does not provide which of the following insurance cover: 75,000 on death or total permanent disability, 30,000 on natural death, 50,000 for medical treatment, 37,500 for partial permanent disability due to accident. Now, the homework or the work that you have to do, which although of course I am going to explain a little bit, is to go through Aam Aadmi Bima Yojana once again. So you can just go to that summary document or the entire document and revise the entire Aam Aadmi Bima Yojana. Okay. The incorrect among this is option C. Option C is incorrect. There is no such classification of 50,000 for medical treatment. So the correct classifications which you have to remember are 75,000 for death or permanent disability, half of that 37,500 for partial disability, 30,000 for natural death. It is administered by Ministry of, or launched under Ministry of Finance and administered through LIC because it is about insurance. It was launched in 2013 and two schemes, Janashri Bima Yojana and Aam Aadmi Bima Yojana, have been combined to form AABY only. It provides death and disability covers, age group 18 to 59 of BPL family, only BPL are covered here. Okay. It also provides scholarship of 100 per month for two children of 9th to 12th standard. So that is also a part of this scheme. Question 30th about National Pension Scheme. Let's go through the question. Which of the following is incorrect statement with regard to Atal Pension Yojana? So the paragraph above talks about National Pension Scheme, but the question is about Atal Pension Yojana because both of them are related to pension. The question is, which of the following is incorrect regarding Atal Pension Yojana? Options are, subscriber should be in the age group of 18 to 40. Subscriber would receive pension ranging between 1000 to 5000 per month. The age of exit would be 60 years and start of pension. Annual premium is 42 to 271. Now, these kinds of actual questions are, yes, asked in the examination. These kinds of facts are often asked and they become difficult to answer if you don't remember them clearly. Okay. Although they look stupid, but these kinds of facts are also important. The correct answer here is option D, because it is incorrect. It is 291, if I am not wrong. It is not 271. So, the annual premium payable, the range is 42 to 291 per month. Okay. This is all about Atal Pension Yojana. It was launched in the year 2019. You also have to cover Atal Pension scheme on your own as well. That's the work that you have to do. Launched in 2015 by Ministry of Finance. Purpose is universal social security program for the poor and underprivileged specifically. Age group 18 to 40 to come under the program. You start receiving pension after you turn 60. Maximum pension that you can get is 5,000 per month. Minimum is 1,000 per month. Annual premium that you have to pay now is 42 to 291, anywhere in between that. Central government would contribute 50% of total contribution that you are giving, or 1,000 per annum, whichever is lower, okay, for a period of 5 years after you enroll. If you are already a member of any other social security scheme, or if you are paying income tax, then you are not eligible under this scheme. This means it is only for people of the unorganized sector and BPL category. Next question, Indians love gold, but due to religious beliefs and traditional practices, they buy and invest in physical gold. So this is about sovereign gold bond scheme. The question is, purchasing gold bonds are beneficial to the subscriber under the sovereign gold bond scheme in comparison to the physical gold. Which option among the following is not correct regarding sovereign gold bond scheme? Carrying bonds are risk-free. Subscriber will deal with the purest form of gold. They can be used as collateral for loans. They are tradable on the stock exchange. The interest and capital gains on gold bonds have been exempted from tax. A very good question, simple yet very quality question, and I want you to pause this video for a while, think and answer this question. The first one is correct. Yes, they are completely risk-free because they have been backed by sovereign government's guarantee. Okay. Second, yes, they deal with purest form of gold, 24 carat. They can be used as collateral for loans, yes. They are tradable on stock exchanges, yes, they are completely tradable. The interest and capital gains on gold bonds are exempted from tax. The interest of 2.5% is not exempted from tax. Only the capital gain, in case you sell those bonds, is exempted from capital gain tax. So, fifth option, option E, is incorrect. Everything else is correct. Minimum investment that you can make is 1 gram and maximum is 4 kg for individuals, 20 kg for trust and entities, and 4 kg for HUF. Okay, the interest I have already told you, 2.5%, which is taxable. This is also important. The bonds are also eligible for SLR purposes in banks. So if a bank holds sovereign gold bonds, it can also use it for SLR purposes, for counting it under SLR. I hope you understand what exactly I mean by this. So this is all about sovereign gold bonds. Let's come to 32nd question. Pradhan Mantri Vyay Vandana Yojana, which is a pension scheme. What is true about this Yojana? It is a pension scheme for senior citizen. It is a pension scheme for workers of unorganized sector. It is a financial inclusion scheme, or it is a scheme to praise brave soldiers. Vyay Vandana is about old people, and therefore option A is the correct one. So directly the objective of Vyay Vandana Yojana has been asked. Something like this can also be asked in the examination. Your responsibility now is to read everything about Vyay Vandana Yojana. Let me also take you through some explanations about this Yojana. It is a pension scheme for senior citizens who are aged 60 years or above. It was launched in 2017 by Ministry of Finance. Scheme is exempted from goods and services tax, being implemented through Life Insurance Corporation. Investment is 15 lakh for senior citizen. Investment limit, that is the maximum that you can invest in order to get pension, is 15 lakh for every senior citizen. What are the advantages of this Yojana, of investing in this Yojana? Let's say I am a senior citizen and I invest in this Yojana. What will I get? I will get a guaranteed interest of 8% for 10 years. Minimum purchase price under the scheme is 1.5 lakh for a minimum pension of 1,000. So if I invest 1.5 lakh, I get interest of 8% plus I also start getting pension of 1,000 per month. And if I invest 15 lakh, I start getting pension of 10,000 per month. And at the end of 10 years, when this, matures, then I get the entire amount back as well, because it's a pension scheme. So these are the advantages, and I also get some interest on it. Okay. Next question, for what purpose Swabhiman campaign has been launched in 2011 and enjoying a great success? So what is the main purpose of an old scheme called a Swabhiman scheme? The options are to bring banking within the reach of masses, to help rural youth in setting up new enterprises, to provide social security to senior citizens, to encourage economically weaker, differently abled students to pursue education in diploma and degree levels. The answer option is A. Swabhiman is basically banking correspondents led scheme, the purpose of which was very clear: financial inclusion, to reach the masses of Indian population and bring banking to them through bank sathi or banking business correspondents. That was the main purpose of Swabhiman campaign or yojana. Next question, consider the following statements with respect to Project Saksham, which has been launched by Ministry of Finance for enabling the new tax system. We have to find out the statement which is not correct about Project Saksham. It is a back-end IT infrastructure project integrating CBEC and GSTN systems. It supports all existing services in customs, central excise, service tax and income tax. This is where the option is wrong. So this one is wrong because it says income tax, whereas this scheme is all about indirect taxes. So it integrates all indirect taxes into under goods and services tax. Project Saksham is developed under Digital India Initiative. The total cost is 2 to 56 crores. So all the other options are correct. Only option B is incorrect. Why? Because it says income tax, whereas Project Saksham is for indirect taxes only. Last question before we move to one markers. It is, the paragraph is about pension plans, about United Nations Population Divisions World Life Expectancy Index. Let's have a look at the question. The question is, who are eligible for availing the National Pension Scheme regulated by PFRDA? So who can be a part of National Pension Scheme? Every person can be a part of National Pension Scheme. Government employees between 18 to 60, yes, they can be. All Indian citizens irrespective of age, all government employees irrespective of age, all Indian citizens between 18 to 65. So this is the correct answer. All Indian citizens between 18 to 65 can be a part of National Pension Scheme. Before it was 18 to 60, now it has been increased to 18 to 65. That's why this question can be asked in the examination. So these are all two markers. I hope you have covered a lot of topics through these questions. Or if you follow my advice and take home those tasks that I've mentioned you focus on these topics and cover these topics immediately through the notes. Now we will be moving towards one markers. Okay, now let's move to one markers. So the first question here is regarding Ajivika Grameen Express Yojana. What does the question say? The question says, to offer members of self-help groups an alternative household income by facilitating them to operate public transport, MRD, Ministry of Rural Development, has launched a sub-scheme called as Ajivika Grameen Express Yojana. So your objective, your responsibility here is to read everything about Ajivika Grameen Express Yojana immediately after this question. So you can pause the video and cover this particular scheme or yojana. Okay, that is your homework. But I am also going to be covering some things about this yojana. The question now says, under this scheme, under which scheme this sub-scheme was launched? So Ajivika Grameen Express Yojana was launched under which sub-scheme? The options are Sansad Adarsh Gram Yojana, Startup Village Entrepreneurship Program, Deen Dayal Upadhyay Grameen Kaushalya or Deen Dayal Antyojaya Yojana, National Rural Livelihoods Mission. Now, number one, this is launched by Ministry of Rural Development. Second, what is the objective? To help members of self-help groups and alternative household income by facilitating them to operate public transport. Okay. The option is D. It is under Deen Dayal Antyodaya Yojana, NRLM. A little bit about Ajivika Grameen Express Yojana. It says it is a new sub-scheme under this. It was implemented in 250 blocks in the country on a pilot basis from 2017-18 to 19-20. The main objective is to provide, as I said, an alternative source of livelihood to members of self-help groups by facilitating them to operate public transport services, for example, e-vehicles. Each block will be provided up to 6 vehicles to operate the transport services. So, they identified that the transport services are not available, either not available or not very good. Therefore, why not help the already organized self-help groups by providing them transport facilities, by providing them, some kind of facilitation so that they can operate transport services. This way, you will try and remember this. Next question is, a special initiative under Deen Dayal Upadhyay Grameen Kaushalya Yojana was taken for the youth of Jammu and Kashmir, both rural and urban. What is the name of this initiative? Inayat, Roshni, Himayat or Hidayat? The answer is, as you must be thinking, very easy, Himayat, option C. So, Deen Dayal Upadhyay Grameen Kaushalya Yojana is tasked with dual objectives of adding diversity to incomes of rural poor people and cater to the career aspirations of rural youth. It was launched in 2014 by Ministry of Rural Development. Deen Dayal Upadhyay Grameen Kaushalya Yojana is a part of NRLM. And it provides special scheme Himayat is launched under Deen Dayal Upadhyay Grameen Kaushalya Yojana, which helps the youth of Jammu and Kashmir, but in this case both rural and urban. This is where I think a question can also be created in the examination, because DDU Grameen Kaushalya Yojana is for rural people. However, it helps rural and urban both in case of Himayat, which is a sub scheme under this Yojana. Okay, so remember this. Now, your work is to read more about Deen Dayal Upadhyay Grameen Kaushalya Yojana. Next, Kaushal Panji, the skill register aims to be citizen centric end-to-end solution to aid mobilization of candidates for dash and dash. Kaushal Panji, it is a skill register which aims to help the citizens. Now, the answer to this question is A, DDU GKY Grameen Kaushalya Yojana and RCT. Now, Kaushal Panji, DDU GKY mobilization of candidates for Grameen Kaushalya Yojana and Rural Self-Employment Training Institutes. So, this skill register creates a register of people and then helps these people by mobilizing the candidates for these two Yojana. Number one, Rural Self-Employment Training Institutes, providing these candidates to these training institutes, and secondly, by connecting them with DDU GKY. Okay. The purpose is to skill them or to provide them employment opportunities. Next question is based on a paragraph. So, you can go to this paragraph, you can pause the video and go to this paragraph. The question is based on Pharma Jan Samadhan scheme. The Pharma Jan Samadhan scheme is a part of Government of India's Digital India initiative created by NPPA, National Pharma Pricing Authority, NPPA. The full form is not available here also, NPPA. Okay. Under the Ministry of Chemical and Fertilizer, which is not correct about the services provided under this online complaint redressal system. Why this question is a one marker and not a two marker? Because this is not such an important ministry. It comes from Ministry of Chemical and Fertilizers. The question is, Pharma Jan Samadhan scheme is a part of Government of India's Digital India initiative created by NPPA under the Ministry of Chemical and Fertilizer. You have to identify which is not correct about online redressal system under this scheme. It provides online services to search MRP. It discovers alternate brands and their prices for given salt. Any person can lodge complaint regarding overpricing. NPPA will initiate action on any complaint within 24 hours of its receipt. Now, a very factual question and a very logical question as well, but the answer is a little illogical, the question that I have created, not very easy to identify. Yes, it does provide online services. Yes, it helps in discovering alternate brands. Yes, it helps a person in lodging complaint. Yes, NPPA initiates action, but it initiates action within 48 hours of receipt and not 24 hours of receipt. So, that's the factual answer that it has. However, the Jan Samadhan scheme is important. A little bit about Pharma Jan Samadhan scheme is a web-enabled system for redressal of consumers' grievances related to pricing and availability of medicines. It was launched in 2015 and created by NPPA, Pharmaceutical Pricing Authority. NPPA is an authority of Department of Pharmaceuticals under Ministry of Chemicals. This also is important, can be asked directly in the examination. Okay. And the services which are a part of the question are all mentioned here. So, you can find out the MRP, you can discover alternative brands, you can lodge complaint, and it has to initiate action within 48 hours. Next question is also based on a paragraph based on IPRs. The question is, taking forward the National Intellectual Property Rights Policy 2016, a scheme for IPR awareness, Creative India, Innovative India, has been launched in the year 2017 by Dash Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion, Ministry of Commerce and Industry, CPAM, IPAB, NEPA and JCAG. Now, your objective is to identify the full forms of all these four acronyms that I have mentioned here. Okay, that is your first task. That is something that you have to do. The answer to this question is A, CPAM. CPAM here stands for Cell for IPR Promotion and Management. Cell for IPR Promotion and Management. So, if you are aware about the full form of CPAM, you would have guessed it without even knowing about the answer. Which of the following is false regarding GST? A very conceptual question. If you understand GST, you should be able to answer this question. It is a dual tax, it is a value-added tax, it is an origin-based tax. It is a destination-based tax and not an origin-based tax. Therefore, this particular option is incorrect. So, this is our answer. We have to identify the false ones. Is it a value-added tax? Yes, it is also a VAT, but at a national level. Is it a dual tax? Yes, it is a dual tax. So, the answer to this question is 3 only. C, 3 only, which is the only incorrect statement that we have here. Next question. Which of the following describes tax expenditure? A very conceptual question. Difference between statutory rate of tax and effective rate of tax. Difference between tax collection and tax payment. Expenditure incurred for collection of taxes. Difference between tax revenue and tax expenditure. Even if you don't understand or don't know what is tax expenditure, I think through the options you can try and eliminate some of the options and come to the right answer. The third option is expenditure incurred for collection of taxes by the government. Let's say the government is collecting 12 lakh crore this particular year and it is going to be incurring certain expenses. Those expenses are administrative expenses, capital expenses in technology, etc., etc. Those should not come under tax expenditures. Those are directly expenditures of the government and not tax expenditures. Okay. So, this can be removed. Difference between tax revenue and tax expenditure. There is nothing called as tax expenditure for the government. It is only tax revenues. Therefore, this is logically incorrect. Difference between tax collection and tax payment. The government does not pay any tax. Again, incorrect. That leaves us with the first option, difference between statutory rate of tax and effective rate of tax. This means the government sets forward certain statutory rates of taxes, but the effective rate of tax might be less than that statutory rate of tax due to certain exemptions, for example. So, that difference between that statutory rate of tax, for example, the statutory rate of tax is 25%. However, the effective rate of tax might be much less at about 21% because of exemptions, because of certain kind of reliefs given to the people, and therefore that difference is called as tax expenditure. Next question is also conceptual in nature. It is based on money supply. The question is, which of the following is a quantitative measure of controlling money supply? So, if you know what are the qualitative measures and what are the quantitative measures, this is a cakewalk for you. Okay. So, this is a conceptual and also a question directly from the syllabus. What are the qualitative and quantitative measures of money supply control? Margin requirements, qualitative. Let's write qualitative as Q and quantitative as N. Market stabilization scheme, this is quantitative. Selective credit control, qualitative. Moral suasion, qualitative. Credit rationing, qualitative. So, our answer is option B. Now, what is your responsibility after this question? You have to go and revise both qualitative and quantitative measures of money supply. And there is a document that I have given in finance theory syllabus part, which explains the entire concept of money supply, quantitative, qualitative measures and everything related to RBI's responsibility of maintaining money supply. Okay. So, you have to cover that immediately. That is very important. Through that revision, it will make sure that in the future videos that we that I discuss questions, they will be very easy for you to answer. Next question, also related to money supply, which of the following refers to monetary policy transmission? This was asked in the this question was asked last year in the interview also by the interview board with a from a lot of students, and this year also monetary policy transmission has been a major issue because of problems with MCLR, external benchmarking versus internal benchmarking. Therefore, it is an important issue. Questions can be asked from it. The options are: central bank's monetary signals are passed on to influence exchange rates. Central bank's monetary signals are passed on to influence the businesses and households. Central bank's monetary signals affect economy in general and prices in particular. Central bank's monetary signals affect fiscal expansion or contraction by the government. First one is central bank's monetary signals are passed on to influence exchange rates. This is correct. Monetary policy transmission, whatever the RBI does, by changing the monetary policy, has an effect on variety of areas, which includes exchange rates as well. Secondary, central bank's monetary signals are passed on to influence businesses and households. Yes, that also happens. Influence on businesses and households also takes place. Monetary signals affect economy in general and prices in particular. That is the primary objective. Central bank's monetary signals affect fiscal expansion or contraction by the government. This is something that does not happen. Central bank's monetary policy transmission has nothing to do with how the fiscal policy or how the government reacts, whether it goes for fiscal expansion or fiscal contraction, because fiscal expansion or contraction is focused on demand of money in the economy or demand of goods in the economy. However, monetary policy is focused on supply of money in the economy. These are two sides of a coin, and therefore one does not affect the other. So the answer is 1, 2 and 3 only. Next question, in economics, GDP deflator. So you are directly asked, what is the formula of GDP deflator? I want you to pause for a while and identify the formula yourself in case you have not seen the answer already. A is GDP at current price upon GDP at constant price. B, GDP at constant price upon GDP at current price. C, GDP at basic price upon GDP at constant price. And D, none of the above. The answer to this question is A, GDP at current upon GDP at constant price. Okay, that is the correct answer for this. So it's a deflator, that's why I'm not discussing it. It's a very conceptual thing. Which of the following is not a part of final expenditure? A very conceptual question based upon your understanding of intermediate expenditures and final expenditures. Seeds purchased by farmers. What is the farmer going to do with these seeds? It is going to sow it. The farmer is going to sow these seeds and convert it into a plant and then sell off the crop. Therefore, it is an intermediate expenditure. Consumer goods purchased by the government, they are going to consume it. Therefore, because they are consumer goods, therefore it is a final expenditure. Government fixed investment expenditure, this is also final expenditure. Exports to other countries, final expenditure in majority of the cases. If the export is of, let's say, intermediate goods, but it is not specified here, therefore the first is the best option. Remember, there will be many questions wherein two or three options might be very close. You have to identify the best option in that case. Seeds purchased by farmers is certainly not a final expenditure. Therefore, A is a better option than D. Fisher equation. What does Fisher equation say? It shows the relationship between nominal and real interest rates under the effect of inflation. The answer to this question is A, nominal interest rates is the sum of real interest rate and inflation. If you remember, the nominal, let's say, GDP of India might be somewhere around 12%. But if the inflation is 5%, the real GDP comes down to something around 7%. This is what we normally use and see in our economy being quoted, not the nominal, nominal GDP. And we don't know, use nominal GDP because inflation has a big impact on our lives, and therefore we try to take it into consideration directly. There is a question on poverty, and this is also a conceptual question. Which of the following is a relative measure of poverty? Now, there are two kinds of measures of poverty: absolute measure, which say whether one is poor or not poor, and relative measure, which says, for example, if I earn 1 lakh per month, let's say I earn 1 lakh per month, but the inflation in the economy is very high and majority of the people are earning, let's say, 20 lakh per month. and let's say one burger costs, instead of costing 100, it costs 10,000. So from absolute measure, I might be above the poverty line or not poor, but relatively, I might become poor. So Gini coefficient in this answer is a relative measure of poverty, all the others because it measures inequality among the people, and all the other measures, headcount ratio, poverty gap, and national poverty indicator, these are all absolute measures of poverty. Gini coefficient to represent the income or wealth distribution of a nation's residents and is the most commonly used measurement of inequality, and all these are mentioned here. Next question, which of the following describes an inferior good? So you have to understand the difference between normal good and inferior good. Good which has positive income effect, good which has upward sloping demand curve, good which has negative income effect, good whose demand increases and income goes up. This is a normal good. Normal good, for example, let's say chicken. Chicken for a person would become a normal good because as your income goes up, your demand for protein is a better measure. As your income increases, your consumption of protein goes up, right? So this is a normal good. Inferior good, on the other hand, is a good whose demand increases when the income increases. As the income goes up, your demand for it goes down. For example, something that is a new development, when your income starts going up, people stop drinking tea or reduce their consumption of tea and instead move to green tea, right? It becomes a status symbol and people stop drinking tea and convert to green tea. So it, in this case, becomes an inferior good. Normal tea becomes an inferior good in this specific small case because this happens a lot nowadays. So inferior good is something which has a negative income effect. The answer is C. The next question is, which of the following refers to the right to emit 1 ton of carbon dioxide or the mass of another greenhouse gas with a carbon dioxide equivalent to 1 ton of carbon dioxide? Now, what this is trying to say is the right to emit 1 ton of carbon dioxide, equivalent to a greenhouse gas. Now, carbon credit, for example, let me explain this because you might not be aware about it. Let's say this is a steel industry and the country says, okay, the steel industry, let's say Tata Steel as one unit, has the ability or has the permission to emit, let's say, 10 million tons of greenhouse gases. So it gets certain carbon credits. Let's say one carbon credit is equal to 1 million tons of greenhouse gases. So it gets 10 carbon credits. So carbon credit is the right, carbon credit, 10 carbon credits is the right of Tata Steel to emit equivalent to 10 million tons of greenhouse gases. Okay. So conversion of your emission of greenhouse gas into some other unit, that unit is carbon credit. The standard deduction for a salaried person has, for salaried persons, has been raised to dash under Union Interim Budget 2019-20 and it was not changed in the final budget. The answer is C, 50,000. These kinds of factual questions might also be asked in the examination, so do cover them. As per Union Interim Budget, the long-term capital gain exemption limit has been increased to dash for a taxpayer to be used once in a lifetime. So you can use it only once in a lifetime and it is only specific to long-term capital gains. So you can get exemption up to 200 lakh or 2 crore. 2 lakh, 20 lakh, 200 lakh, 200 lakh would be 2 crore. Who among the following is the head of committee made to review economic capital framework? We've already covered economic capital framework in detail. The answer is C, Bimal Jalan. Approval has been granted for creation of AMIF with a corpus of 2000 crore. AMIF is to be created with which organization? Answer is D, NABARD. Which organization has released the above report? So in this case, we need to go through the paragraph. Recently, the State of World's Children report has been released, which ranks countries in the order of highest burden of death among children under 5. So this is talking about State of World's Children report. WHO, UNICEF, World Bank, FAO, and IMF. With this question, you have to go back to the document on indices and reports and read the entire document, or if not, at least read World's Children Report 2019. The answer is UNICEF. What is the position of India out of total of 190 countries in what World Bank's ease of doing business? This had been revised recently. The answer is 63. It was 77. It has increased or improved by 14 counts. So now it is 63. Remember this, very high chances that this is going to be asked in the exam. 10% reservation for economically weaker section has been approved by Indian Parliament as which Constitutional Amendment Act? The answer is 103rd Constitutional Amendment Act. Again, a factual question. Female labor force participation rate has declined to what in 2017? The answer is B, 17%. With this, I want you guys to read right now, read the entire PLFS, Periodic Labor Force Survey. There are some very important facts, and I'm assuming, and I'm very sure, not assuming, I know that 4 to 5 questions can also be asked from Periodic Labor Force Survey. So all the facts should be on your fingertips. Okay, and this is one of them. Which among the following is a reason for falling foreign reserves in India? Appreciation of rupee. Does appreciation of rupee means less foreign reserves? Rise in import cost. When the import cost goes up, does it result in falling foreign reserves? Heavy investment of foreign investors in India. It results in more reserves. So this is certainly not an answer. A stable rupee taking away the possibility of arbitrage for foreign investors. Stable rupee means more foreign investment. Therefore, this is not also an answer. When the import cost goes up, then you have to pay more for your necessary imports. And therefore, the direct answer is B, rise in import cost of India. Caste census comes under the administrative control of which of the following ministries? Caste census. Caste census comes under Ministry of Home Affairs Registrar. Here, I have written in detail about socioeconomic caste census. Socioeconomic caste census is a study of socioeconomic status of rural and urban households both and allows ranking of households based on predefined parameters. There are three census components of socioeconomic caste census which were conducted by three separate authorities but under the overall coordination of Department of Rural Development in the Government of India. Census in rural area has been conducted by Department of Rural Development. In urban area, it has been created by Ministry of Housing and Urban Poverty Alleviation. Caste census is in the administrative control. So, the administrative control belongs to Ministry of Home Affairs. However, overall coordination is done by Department of Rural Development in Ministry of Rural Development. Okay. So, remember this, coordination by Ministry of Rural Development, administrative control, Ministry of Home Affairs. These are two different things and done by different ministries. So, this is very important. That's how they can actually get your answer wrong. Which of the following are not true regarding socioeconomic caste census? First, paperless census, ranking of households on socioeconomic status, first caste-based census covered under the Census of India Act 1948. Is it the first paperless census? Yes. Has it ranked households on socioeconomic status? Yes. Is it the first caste-based census of India? No. It is the first caste-based census of independent India. The previous caste-based census was carried out in 1931. And is it covered under Census of India Act? Option C, 3 and 4 are wrong. No, it is not covered under Census of India Act as well. Okay. The question is, RBI highlighted the issue of liquidity crunch being faced by banking system. It took the following steps for injecting liquidity in the system. The options are, infusing liquidity through open market operations, increasing facility to avail liquidity for LCR, reducing statutory liquidity ratio, injected rupee liquidity for through long-term foreign exchange buy or sell swaps. So, all these four initiatives or steps were taken by RBI for injecting liquidity in the system. So, the answer is option A, all are correct. The next question is, which institute publishes Global Financial Stability Report? Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, IMF, World Bank or OECD? The answer is B, IMF. With this, you have to go back to indices and reports and at least find out Global Financial Stability Report and what does the recent report say. With regard to World Health Report, choose the targets as per SDG 3. So, this is a question which tells you how SDG questions based on SDG can be asked in the examination. Number one, reduce the global maternal mortality rate ratio to less than 70 per 1 lakh live births by 2030. By 2020, half the number of global deaths and injuries from road traffic accidents. By 2030, end all forms of malnutrition. End preventable deaths of newborns and children under 5 years by 2030. The answer is D, 1, 2 and 4. It does not say by 2030, end all forms of malnutrition. It is not a part of SDG 3, although it is a part of SDGs, but it is not a part of SDG 3. Therefore, this is incorrect. This is available, or this has been picked up directly from the document on SDGs which I provided. Okay, so you can go through that as well. With regard to gender inequality index, what are the dimensions to measure the opportunity cost of gender inequality? Reproductive health, crime against women, empowerment, labor market. Labor market participation, yes. You have to measure, you are measuring opportunity cost of gender inequality. Reproductive health, yes. Crime against women or empowerment. Which of the following is not one of them, is not one of the measures of opportunity cost of gender inequality. Crime against women is not one of them. Empowerment, reproductive health and labor market participation are the three measures which measure the opportunity cost of gender inequality. Okay, so this was the last question. So we are done with a total of 65 questions, test 5. Tomorrow I will be covering one test of finance and management. Okay, today I'll be providing you this particular session which has covered test 5 of ESI, through which I have covered 65 questions, and if not less, then more than 50 topics have been covered. Now your responsibility is to cover these topics on your own as well immediately, so that your chances of remembering them and recalling them increase very, very much. I hope you like the session. All the very best. Take care.